One of the major influences on my faith life is Ignatius of Loyola. Those of you who came through the Roman Catholic tradition may be familiar with him. He was a 16th century Spaniard who founded the Society of Jesus, or Jesuits, an order of Catholic priests. I'm Jesuit educated, so is my spiritual director, and the work of Ignatius has been a way for me to reclaim what was holy and life-giving about my Catholic upbringing. There was a lot that was awful, but there was good too. And it turns out that Ignatian spirituality is very compatible with the Episcopal Church. Ignatius Loyola had the gift of spiritual guidance. He wrote a manual for retreat directors that is still used today. He is especially known for his teaching on discernment, the fancy church word for prayerful decision-making. Ignatius talks about the importance of freedom when followers of Jesus make choices. And by freedom, he means detachment, indifference to our own desires so that we can be fully present to God's will for us, which is that we love and serve God and our neighbors. Ignatius has a meditation about three people and their relationship with money. The first wants freedom to follow God's will, but never gets around to talking with God about money. The second also wants freedom and tries to use his money in faithful and generous ways. But instead of asking how God wants him to use his money, he asks God to bless the choices he has already made. He's keeping control over the decision. The third person is not attached to keeping her money, nor is she attached to giving her money away. Her only desire is to be open to whatever God would have her do with her money. And she, Ignatius says, has found true freedom. For Ignatius, freedom is not an end in itself. Freedom always has a purpose. We are freed from our own desires so that we can fully embrace God's purpose for us, love and service of God and neighbor. Decisions are all over this gospel, beginning with the decision Jesus makes to set his face to go to Jerusalem. Jesus is from Galilee, about a 4 or 5 day walk north of Jerusalem. Faithful Jews like Jesus made pilgrimages to Jerusalem 3 times a year. It's not unusual for Jesus to be headed there. But this is no ordinary pilgrimage. This time, Jesus is going towards his arrest, torture, execution, and eventually resurrection. The final confrontation with the Roman authorities and the Jewish leadership can end only one way. Jesus knows his suffering and death are inevitable, and he decides that he's as ready as he's going to be. It's time. There are 2 roads to Jerusalem from Galilee, one along the Jordan River that is fast but hot and has a brutal climb at the end, another that meanders through Samaritan territory. Samaritans and Jews are cousins locked in a bitter family feud. They both worship the one God. They're both descended from Abraham. But Samaritans worship on Mount Gerizim, and Jews worship at the temple in Jerusalem. Samaritans do not extend hospitality to Jews making pilgrimage to Jerusalem. They're worshiping in the wrong place. Yet Jesus sends his advance team anyway, knowing they're likely to be rejected. They are rejected. James and John take offense. They ask Jesus, "Do you want us to burn them down?" Jesus decides no. Punishing people for rejecting him does not love and serve God and neighbor, and it's hardly going to make Samaritans change their mind about Jews. Other people Jesus meets are more open to following him. But following a traveling Messiah on the road to Jerusalem entails hard choices. Do you want a home of your own, or do you want to follow Jesus? Do you want to bury your father, or do you want to follow Jesus? Do you want to say farewell to your family, or do you want to follow Jesus? Having a home, fulfilling your obligation to your parents, telling your loved ones where you're going are all good things, all reasonable and important things to want. Jesus sounds kind of extreme in forcing these people to choose. Shouldn't you be able to do these good, reasonable, important things and follow him too? Jesus is offering an alternative society, one where following him comes above all else. All else. He's been bringing the kingdom of God near since he called his first disciples. And the road to Jerusalem is where the kingdom becomes closest and most real. On the road, Jesus tells stories of lost sheep, lost coins, lost sons being found. He proclaims blessing on those who hear the word of God and obey it. He counsels his followers not to worry about what they will eat or what they will wear, because when they strive for the kingdom of God, all these other things will be given to them as well. This is amazingly good news when the world is as messed up as it is. Jesus says, "This broken world is not God's will. God has another dream for the world, where God's purpose of wholeness, healing, and justice is fulfilled for all people and all creation." That's the kingdom of God. The kingdom does not function according to the normal rules. To be part of it, you have to reframe your values and get ready for unorthodox ways of thinking and being. You can't hold on to your own life and also participate in the kingdom of God. Jesus and his alternative society demand your total commitment. I wish we knew what happened to those three prospective disciples. What do they do? Do they go back to their homes and families, or do they follow Jesus? Because the same choice faces us. Do we do the other good, responsible, important things, or do we follow Jesus? This is where the wisdom of Ignatius Loyola comes in. When we cultivate detachment, when we reach inner freedom, we are fully present to God's will for us, to love and serve God and our neighbors. And we seek to do only God's will. Detachment and freedom seem daunting, but we don't start with the huge life-changing decisions. We work up to bigger decisions by starting with small things. Like, do I volunteer to serve lunch at street church today? Or do I take a nap? Ignatius encourages us to look for the complexity in each option, especially our motivations. Loving and serving my neighbors at street church might seem like the obvious choice. But maybe I want to volunteer because my ego gets a terrific boost from it. My desire to serve is rooted in selfishness. The nap might seem selfish, but maybe I haven't been sleeping well for a while, and resting today will make me better able to love and serve God and my neighbors tomorrow. When I acknowledge these things and let go of my preference for either choice, I can ask God for guidance, trusting that God will show me what God wants me to do this afternoon. As we get comfortable with detachment from these everyday choices, our inner freedom grows, and gradually we become more and more fully present to God's loving will. I think this is what the Apostle Paul is talking about in the letter to the Galatians. Paul has this epic tug of war going on between the spirit and the flesh. Flesh is a literal translation. A more idiomatic phrase would be selfish desires. You were called to freedom, Paul says. You were called to detachment from your selfish desires. When you live by the Spirit in freedom, you naturally turn away from your selfish desires. You let go of your need to control the outcome. You know you're living in your selfish desires when you're doing things that tear yourself and others down. Using others for your own needs, arguing, turning away from God, starting conflict, causing drunken disorder. But when you live in the Spirit, you move through the world in the fruits of the Spirit. You're able to make decisions out of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You have freedom to be completely open to God's will. You might be expecting me to say that when we cultivate detachment and grow in freedom, we will set aside the other good, reasonable, important things in our lives and choose to follow Jesus. But I don't want to box any of us in, because Jesus gives us the choice. His call to follow him is never a demand. It's always an invitation. And invitations can be declined. Jesus passed by the Samaritan village without raining down fire on them. He will not punish us for saying no. Instead, when we choose to cultivate detachment from selfishness, we will grow in freedom so that we can be fully present to God's will for us, whatever that might be. And we can trust that God, who created us, redeemed us, and sustains us, will guide us where we need to go.